Oh my God, I'm so excited to be here again in Energy Poland. This is one of my favorite conferences, and I'm having so much fun here. Thank you so much for being here and for staying so late for my talk. Okay, so we're going to talk about reactive powered angular forms, reactive forms, and RxJS, double reactive. Where are the angular forms are really reactive, and how do we use RxJS with them? I don't need to introduce myself anymore. I'm a cloud advocate at Microsoft, and we're having NG Girls here as part of NG Poland and NGS Poland on Saturday. We still have some space left. If you know someone who would like to participate and learn Angular and create her own very own first Angular application with us, or if you want to be a mentor, and also guys can be mentors, or you know someone who might want to be a mentor, we'd love to have you. So talk to me or to Robert from our team after the talk. Speaking of NG Baby, so this is NG Baby last year in NG Poland with React Dad. Last year NG Baby was only learned how to crawl, and today I think we should start calling him NG Toddler. He's running around everywhere. But they're not here with me this time. They're at home, probably watching or wishing me luck here. Okay, so first of all, let's start with a demo. Okay, so this is the application. The application that we're talking about is an application for selecting seats in a room like this one, like this room. Imagine you're going to NG Poland, but it's a very rare use case where you have to also select where you're sitting while you're in the conference. Or you're actually coming here to watch a movie and you're buying tickets for the movie, and then you select your seats. So this is my demo application. It might not be exactly how you would implement it in a real use case, in a real application, but I found a way to showcase a lot of reactive stuff here, and you might take some inspiration out of it. So what we have here? We have here custom controls. Every seat is a custom control that I wrote. There are different seat types, so they have different colors. So maybe a seat for children, seats for disabled, and so on. And when you select a seat, it's colored. Okay, you can see that it's selected. And you also have real-time data about the seats that are already occupied while you're selecting. So you can see the seats that are disabled are occupied, but some of them are also released because maybe someone occupied them but then changed their mind. Okay? So you always get this update. And we also have real-time validation, because maybe I selected a seat, but oops, it was already occupied, and I didn't get this data in time, so there's an asynchronous validation. And look again what it's doing. If I'm selecting this seat that is occupied, then I will get an error message, and also the seat is unselected and disabled. Also look at the count of the seats that we have here. It is increasing or decreasing with my selection, and if a seat that I'm selecting is occupied, then it goes back down. The error message also is nice. You see that after 2 seconds, the error message disappears. Actually, I think 2 seconds is too short, but you can also close it with the X. All right, so far so good? Nice application. Great. Thank you. Yeah. So let's see what we have here. Where are the reactive stuff in this use case? And first of all, why even bother and do a form, okay? Why can't I just do like divs and unclick and stuff like that? Well, because of a lot of things. There's user input, user interaction, so immediately this tells me, okay, this is a form. There's validation, asynchronous validation, which I showed you, but also you can add more validation, like select seats that are together, don't leave gaps. Disable selecting a occupied seat, so disabling a control is something that you do in forms. Getting data from the server and updating the form when we're building it and in real time when we're using it, and submitting the values, of course. So how reactive are actually the reactive forms in Angular? Because they are called reactive forms. And where can we use observables with the reactive forms? And how can we utilize RxJS even more than we usually do with the form? So I'm really taking it to the extreme here, and let's see how we're doing this. So what we'll see is creating the form, getting data asynchronously from the server to create the form, the room configuration that I need, how many seats there are, how many rows there are, what are the seat types, getting real-time updates about the selected for the occupied seats, selecting the count of the selected seats is also an observable, asynchronous validations, and reacting on errors, showing the display message, and updating the seat that is to unselect it and disable it. All of this I'm doing, I'm going to show you, and I'm doing with observables. So, yeah. thanks, Michael. So, first of all, by the way, thanks, Michael, for also helping me with this talk. You have your name on the last slide, but thank you. Initializing the form. So, the first item of data that I have is the room ID and my URL, okay? I click on a form, room name, and it takes me to the page with the router and the parameter of the ID of the room. So this is the one place where it all begins. So we have the router and the route params. So I am taking from it the room ID parameter. Okay, route params is an observable because the route can change all the time. So every time it changes, every time the params change, the observable emits the value of the params, of the new params. So I'm mapping from it, I'm taking all the params, and taking only the ID. Then I'm taking this ID and switching map. So mapping, you know, it's only taking one value and changing it to another. But now I have the ID and I switch map to another observable because I'm doing a call to the server to get the room configuration. And so I get a new observable now, room config. And from the room config, now I know how many rows I have, how many seats in every row, what are the seat types. Now I can build my form, build seat controls in the form. So I have this method that we're going to see in a moment, create seats from a form, but again, it's a synchronous method. So I'm mapping the room configuration to the form and having another observable. Now I will need to share it because we're using this form in two places, one in the template and another one I will show you soon. And last thing, yeah, this is the share. And last thing, I also can get the room name again from the room configuration. So you can see already how from one piece of data one source, I can get multiple observables, and I can subscribe to each of them independently. And if I subscribe to Room ID, it doesn't affect my subscription to Room Config or to the form, and so on. And that's a great thing with observables, in my opinion. You can take one piece of data and split it and manipulate it, and everyone will use only what they need without affecting the other one. You can also have multiple subscribers to one observable, and the subscribers will not affect each other. So you can unsubscribe without worrying about the other subscriptions. Okay, so this is the first step, and now we're creating the form. Now you probably know how to create the forms with reactive forms. I'm doing it here without the form builder. I have the room configuration, and I'm creating, first of all, the form group, and then I'm creating the array of the rows. So I'm taking the room configuration and taking the rows out of it, mapping it, and returning a new form array. Actually, in my real application, I'm creating another form group which will have the seats as a new form array. And inside the form array now is for each seat in the row. Okay, so I have an array of arrays, and these arrays are of seat controls. And I'm not showing you the implementation of my custom control, but I wanted to show you that I have not only one value in this control. I actually keep a lot of data there that maybe should not be changed, like row ID, seat ID, the seat type. All of these things are used inside the form control, the seat control. But also they will help me when I have, for example, an error message, and I'll want to know where it comes from. So if I have an error on a certain seat, the form doesn't tell me in which array, which place in the array this seat is. But it emits from this control. So the control itself, the seat itself, can tell me its row ID and its seat ID and all the information that I need. Okay, so I do keep the data that we're changing, whether it's selected or not, and whether it's already occupied by someone else or not is actually, I don't really need it here, because I don't need to save this data, because it will be reflected by whether it's disabled or not. When the seat is occupied, then the control is disabled, and that's my way to know. And I don't really need this data when submitting my selection to the server. Okay. Updating the data from the server. So if you get the data when you initialize the form, if you get the initial occupied seats, then you have this option. Instead of creating the form control, with only the value, you create it with an object of a value and disabled. Okay, so if it's occupied, then it's also disabled. So that's one way to do it. But I'm getting real-time data. Okay, so if I'm getting real-time data, that's another observable that I can utilize here. Again, I have the room ID, which is my source of truth here. And I'm taking it and switching map to get the updates, because I need the updates for this specific room. And then I will also need to update to get the seats from these from the data that I'm getting. I need to get the specific seat controls from the form and update them, either disable or enable them. Okay, so I need this data with my latest form that I built. And so I'm using again this observable of the form, and remember that I piped the share operator for the form control, form observable. That's the reason why. Because if I don't share it, I will get a new instance of this observable with maybe It will be a whole form, but it will be a different instance of what is displayed on my screen. So any changes on it will not affect what we see on the screen. But if we share it, then it's the same instance. And then I subscribe. And I know we try to limit how much we subscribe to things, to observables, but sometimes we just need to, because we can't always just use the async pipe. Sometimes it's in the logic. So I subscribe here, and please don't forget to unsubscribe if it makes sense when the control or the form is destructed or something. When we subscribe for something that has with latest from, then we actually get an array of the two values, the what we switch map to, so the updates, and the form. And then we can use these values in our side effects. So we iterate over the updates, we get the row ID and the seat ID and values of the seats that we need to update, and we find them in the form using get. And then once we have the control in our hand, we can update it. So if it's actually occupied, then we disable it, and if not, then we enable it. Now, pay attention here that I'm using emit event false, meaning I don't want the form to notify me about this change of the control that it was disabled or enabled. Why? Because it will disturb my counting of the selected seats, because every time I enable or disable a seat, then it acts as if the seat value has changed and will mess up my count. So I don't want it to mess up my count if it was made from this background process of my server. Okay? So we saw how we're creating the form. Right? Yeah? And now counting. So I mentioned counting now, right? How do we actually count how many seats were selected? So here I create a new behavior subject for that, selected seats change. And when I create the form, so remember that I created the form here, and you see that I, while creating every seat control, I first put it as a const and then return it. Why? Because then I'm using this seat control constant before returning it. I subscribe to observables that are giving to us from the seat control, from the form controls. So it has the value changes observable. So each time the value changes, first of all, I want to see that that it changed to something new. So either selected or not selected. So that's why I pipe distinct until changed, because there might be other changes that are not relevant. Or sometimes we get updates even if it wasn't really changed. And then I map it to, if it's selected, then I give one, and if not, then minus one. And I subscribe to all these controls and push this value, I emit this value, one or minus one, to the selected seats change observable subject that I created in the first line. So I'm controlling what I'm emitting there. So I have this one subject that emits one or minus one, and then the observable that I will actually use in my template is a different observable, number of seats, which pipes this one and minus one and uses scan operator, which is like reduce, but for observables. So it always knows the last value that you had, like the accumulation, what you try to calculate, and it adds the latest, the new addition. Okay, so every time that I have one, it will add another one, one, one. If I have minus one, then it will subtract, and the initial value is zero, of course. Okay, so great use of scan and the behavior is subject to control or values. What happens if my selection is invalid with the async validation? Then, again, I take when I create the seed control, I again use it and subscribe to status changes, but first I pipe it. So status changes tells me whether it's valid, invalid, or so on. And so again, I want distinct until changes. I want to filter only the invalid values. And then I subscribe to it. And I have another observable, another subject that I control, the error subject, because the errors that I show are for the whole application and not for a specific control. So I do next on this error subject with the errors that I have. And I still have the seed control, so I set its value to selected false. I take all the other values and they stay the same. And I also disable it. And pay attention that when disabling it, the status also changes back to valid. Okay? Here, when disabling, I don't use the emit event false. I do want it to emit the event that I'm disabling, so the count does go down one. All right, so I'm out of time. There's a bit more to talk about error messages and how I did all this thing that it shows you either for a few seconds or you can click on the X and it disappears. We can also talk about the validation, asynchronous validation, and how to write it. But I will share all the code and the slides. And all the notes. And just to summarize, the observables that we have in the forms that are given to us are value changes and status changes. We also have the asynchronous validation, of course. And we used more observables from the route parameters, the data that we get from the database, and the subject that we created for counting the seeds, the error messages, and closing the pop-up is also a subject that that we create the emit events. And another important thing is that when you're using reactive methods, operators, and so on, it's easy to test. So look at the documentation, how to test it with fake async, set timeout, and so on. I wanted to thank again Michael Ladke and Jan-Niklas Wortmann, who were speakers here today, and they helped me a lot preparing this talk, preparing the code. And I followed Jan-Niklas' advice. First, try out the stuff, and second, if something doesn't work out, ask him. And thank you so much for being here. I hope you learned something new, and if you have any questions, I'm here and online. Thank you so much.